glad to be here.
Pat?
Betty's here.
Welcome you to Los Angeles.
Nothing like spontaneous.
What you don't know is that's our theme song, so.
I had to have that in.
How are you?
You guys look good. Hello, George.
Hello, Richard. Just to you, welcome.
Here's a big day for us. Let me tell you something, to see these guys together again after what? I mean, the last time we were all in the same room was 20 years ago, I guess, right?
What do we do now? Spontaneously combust.
Check out the art there.
All right.
It looks great.
It really came out great.
Thank you.
Finally coming out after 18,000 years of negotiations. Anyway, it's
so I guess that
great
kind of wraps it up. I think we can.
Okay. See you later.
Yeah, it was a huge disappointment, as you guys remember, hearing from the record company that they didn't really get that record. It was a whole new set of faces over there. And when we brought the record in, they were just like, well, what do we do with this? And, you know, when the record company says, what do we do with this? You know that it's...
Well, they purged a lot of acts right then, RCA did.
And not just that particular record company. That was happening everywhere.
I was in my living room. I got a phone call from you.
I remember when we got the news that it really wasn't going to happen. You know, it came at an odd time because the album was sounding great, and yet it seemed like it was difficult to make. I don't know how you guys felt. It was really difficult.
It was difficult.
And personally, I felt like, you know, this has just got to be the end, because I had thoughts about doing my own thing and. You know, I'd been met with a little bit of resistance from some of the songs that I brought in from everybody. So I still resent you guys for that to this point. And I'm actually really upset about it.
Sorry.
Kidding.
I mean, that's it now for 20 more years.
Yeah. Slug came in with that idea. You remember?
Yeah.
Yeah. We struggled with the title. I remember that.
You did?
Does it have
I
a
love
title?
That title. That yeah, was John's title.
We laid away from Learning to Crawl because it was a pretender song, or even the name of the record.
It?
So didn't we call it, Ever Slowly for a while? It went through a few names.
I do remember that.
That was one of my favorite lyrics. Born a flashing of light, a stride of a grave, and the rest is learning to crawl. You're waiting in my
dreams. I remember we used to call that one Son of Broken Wings at some point.
Oh, yeah. That was a song, actually, that started as a song to be pitched for a Cameron Crowe movie called Say Anything.
Didn't know that.
Yeah, I got the call to do that. Well, it didn't make it into the movie. But in the meantime, Paul got a hold of it, and he's like, what is this, you know? And he loved the riff. I'll be your crazy boy. Can we pull John into this thing? Come on, John. Get in.
Yeah, last time I was this close to you, Slug, I was drunk and I kissed you. Don't want to talk about it.
It was actually a graffiti on the side of a wall of a building in an alley where I was living at the time. But somebody had spray painted Crazy Boy on the side of that, and I came out one morning. Close
your eyes. I remember we were on 2-inch tape in those days, so we could slow the tape down. Because when you play a faster tempo, a lot of times your eighth note hi-hat becomes quarter notes. You don't get the in-between beat to speak enough. So I slowed it down enough that I could really chug the in-between eighth notes and get the feel that I thought was appropriate to the song. Then we sped that back up.
So you cheated.
I did absolutely cheat on that.
There are Steve George moments in every song, you know? And they're unique to you because you have such a giant palette to choose from. And that, you know, Weather Report-ish type melody in the bridge there, that just kind of sails and it takes you on this journey, and then it kind of brings you right back to the pop song.
Gabriel Garcia Marquez wrote a book called Life in the Time of Cholera that I was really taken with.
It
was
Love
in the Time of Cholera, that I was really moved by. And about a person who, like Crazy Boy, is waiting against all odds to hopefully hook up, with maybe his life partner, which... Who's taken a completely different path. And so against all odds, this person does, in the book, he does wait. He waits literally a lifetime, 50 years, before he can hook up with her.
So that tune doesn't take the usual form,
No. Yeah, that's right. We didn't know where that song was going.
No.
I remember thinking, this is just too unwieldy.
Yeah.
We have to bring it back to some form. But it took on a life of its own.
It really did.
The story is very conciliatory, that the person is welcoming the other person into their world, even though they may not even know why.
I like the lyric, I offer you these roses, feel the cut of every thorn.
Yeah.
It's a good...
We belong to no one. I think that was my title.
Yes.
Yeah. One of your favorite songs, right?
It is. Really like that track. Always have.
Happy for you.
Thanks.
I like the arrangement of it because the arrangement is so not pop. The sounds, the colors of it. So there's a good contrast, I think, on that song. In retrospect, I look back and I go, why did we do it in that key?
Because now it's so high you can't sing it.
But even then,
I think even then you
wrestled with
it.
Remember we had nothing for the bridge. And then the record didn't come out, and so a while back I pulled it out again and added some stuff to the bridge, and I noticed that on the website somebody had written in, wow, new vocals on the bridge of Burning Bridge.
How did they know there were no vocals on
the one?
Because they had heard a bootleg version of it. No words to say. That song for me was a direct recollection of my growing up in Montgomery, Alabama in the 50s, in the heat of the civil rights movement, being a little kid, and not really getting why there were black and white, white and colored drinking fountains and restrooms. And so years later, I had to reflect on the silence of people who knew better. And so the whole song has to do with growing up in the South in that turbulent time and watching nobody doing anything about it. And that song is in 11.
It's in 11.
Odd time.
The 11 thing came because I kept putting an extra beat in there by accident. And when I recorded, I didn't realize it was in 11. I just had this extra beat that I'd been singing in my head for 20 minutes.
I did not.
Bar 5 and the bar 6 was really what it was.
And a great sax solo on there.
How are we going to do that live?
Well, just play with one hand. Yeah, that was like the party song of the album, right? Just a jam. It was like the groove that we had going. That we couldn't really figure out if there was a song in there, a lyric in there. I don't think there ever was. So we just gave up on that. And everybody got to take their turn going in there. And banging on something.
Set up a lot.
I had a beer bottle, I think, that had just the right amount of liquid in it.
You both did, actually.
Yeah, and so we went in, and it was the right pitch. The package looks great. The album sounds great. It's been remastered by Bob Ludwig.
There was a lot of work and craftsmanship involved in the record, and then to have it get shelved was disappointing, so.
It feels good because it feels like there's some closure to it.
Yeah, that's the great thing. I'm just thrilled that it's finally going to be put out there and people can hear it.
Fans for years have been, every time I turn around and somebody's asking me when is Pool coming out. And, there have been numerous bootleg versions of it around the internet that sound awful. And that's not how we wanted this album to be remembered.
If you played these songs live, what would you change?
The key. I know, I told Pat, I said, I can't sing that high. And he goes, I can't play that fast. Don't